to everyone watching and listening around the world, and welcome. Today we are speaking with John Kamak. John is a financial management consultant for NGOs and a facilitator of one of IMA's open courses, Sustainable Finance. He has been involved with international development for over 25 years, working with international organisations in over 60 countries and with groups at all levels. He is dedicated to communicating and teaching about the importance of sustainable financial management and has written many publications about financial management training, which are widely used in the NGO sector. And I'm really looking forward to finding out more about John's life, work and experiences today. So hello, John, and thank you for speaking with me today.
Thanks, Olivia.
And so, first question I have for you, John, is what are the highlights of your work over the years?
Yeah, I think primarily it's the people, probably, more than anything else that I've met along the way, colleagues and those I've met when facilitating courses and in projects I've visited. Those are the things that stick in my memory in over quite a long period. And I think being able to meet and share experiences with those from, well, many different cultures and what I've learned from them, both in humanitarian responses, visiting refugee camps and things like that, but also in longer term development situations where people are committed to a longer term programme. And I think really I found it helpful for me to learn from them and put some of that learning into the knowledge I've now got and that I put into training work and writing.
Absolutely, I agree. Some of the best experiences I've had in my life have been learning from other people and particularly other cultures. And I've lived in and worked abroad myself, and just you learn so much from other people and the ways that they live their lives. And it's such a rich and such valuable knowledge that you gain from them. So I agree with you, that's really wonderful. And what interested you about financial management and led you to becoming a consultant in financial management for NGOs?
Well, I originally qualified when I started work as an accountant. And I also completed a master's degree in international development management. So it was a combination of those things. And I see financial management really as a means to an end rather than an end in itself. So for me, it's about what can finance do to improve programme quality and impact rather than just doing it for its own sake. That's what I'm passionate about. And I think I've seen many organisations and programmes that have been transformed by being able to manage their finances in a professional way. And it's always wonderful to see how things can change by looking at finance in that way. And when we work with organisations, as we do in the sector, that are facing really difficult challenges and really struggling, I think finance is one thing you can do which really moves things on a bit without, you know, and you can, you know, ways to do that. You can do that. That's not so difficult, although people do find numbers sometimes difficult. But compared with all the other challenges, it's something we can do which improve the quality of the programme and what we do. I often use the phrase as a shorthand, good finance equals good development. And I think that kind of sums up what we're doing with finance in the sector.
Absolutely. And I think at all levels, finance is really important. And I think that there's never really going to be a time when it's not really important in different ways. And I think because of that, looking at finance in a sustainable way is really key to long-term development. It's really interesting that you said those things. So why is training people in financial management within the international development sector important to you?
Yeah, well, I think I feel very much that we want to empower people in the sector to develop financial management skills, to improve their own skills and organisational capacity. And it's something that I think is is different to what you would do if you were a professional finance person. So if you were a professional finance person, you might be doing all the figures and getting all the different systems working. I think for many people within the sector who are not finance professionals, probably managers or working with a program, that sort of thing, they need skills which are at a slightly different level to those who are dealing with finance all the time. So they want to interpret what's happening and make sure that they understand the financial information so they can make better decisions. And I think I've seen this over the period of the pandemic over the last few years, where many organisations have really struggled with the need to be able to get funding. And at the same time, the demand on their services has increased no end. And helping organisations like that to become more financially sustainable, well, perhaps it was seen at one stage just as a good idea and something it'd be good to do. But now I think for many, it's a matter of whether they can survive or not. Mm-hmm. If they've not got their finances in good order and they've not got enough funding to carry on, then some of them just go out of business, and the people who would benefit from their services then are left without any services to help.
Mm. Mm, absolutely. And I think that training areas within financial management is more important than ever for so many people, to enable them, as you say, to help their business and their organization, particularly because of the pandemic. And I know that it's one of the things that we talk about in IMA's sustainable finance courses. You know, it's the longevity of the decisions that you make, but making sure that those decisions are informed and enabling people from all areas to make those informed decisions based on the training we provide. So it's a really key area, and absolutely is more important now than ever because of the pandemic. So the last question I have for you really is, and sort of a nice one to end on, what are you inspired by? There's so much happening at the moment in the world, and it's nice to sort of to think on the positives and think about what inspires us to keep working and working with people. So what inspires you?
Yeah, I think it's back to the people, actually. And I find at both ends of the international development spectrum, there are people who are inspiring. So on the one side, I suppose the fundraising side and the education side, all of that bit. So when, for example, an emergency appeal is launched, the response that you get is extraordinary. I think people are very committed and give a lot of their funds, which, you know, for some, it might be very easy to give that amount of money. Others really struggle and still want to contribute. And I know when I used to work at Oxfam, one of the things that we noticed all the time when we had appeals was the areas that were the poorest in our country were the ones who tended to be most generous. There was a kind of correlation between the two, which I find is kind of heartwarming and reassuring that people who probably recognise the problems of the world because they're suffering them as well, are the ones who are more likely to be generous. And it's a generalisation, of course, but I think there is some correlation there, which is really inspiring to see that. But also, I think at the other end of the service delivery, wherever the money goes to be providing whatever is needed in those communities. And it's often with people who are, you know, fighting against all the odds. They don't give up. They just go into work day after day, year after year, and do their thing. And that commitment over time, I think, is incredibly inspiring. And what people do and can achieve is sometimes extraordinary to see. Mm. I was delivering some online training just recently, and it was very interesting because one of the participants apologize for not being at one of the training sessions, and she told me, she said, well, I'm really sorry I can't go, but I've got to go and collect some women who've been trafficked from another country to another country from our country, and I need to now go to the border of the neighboring country and collect those women and bring them back home. And her passion and commitment, I just felt those was inspiring. And it just puts what we do into a perspective in a way. You think, well, we're not doing very much, and yet we're working with these people who have got extraordinary stories about what they're doing day to day. And, you know, for her, it was a dangerous journey. She, you know, she could have got killed on the way or anything, but still she was prepared and committed enough to do that. And I think those are the kind of stories I feel inspired by, that people are able to do that and carry on doing that, you know, day after day, and just keep going.
Yes, I mean, when if we can have one thing for one another, I think it's compassion, and that sort of fuels people's drive and want to work and help other people in any way that they can. And it is really, is really inspirational, some of the stories you hear about people. And, you know, we can sit behind our desks and work away on various bits of work and think, what are we doing this for? And then you meet people like that and you think,
yeah,
that's why we're doing things, that the things that we're doing, and why we're working towards a collective positive change in the world and in so many different ways. So that's a really lovely note to end on. Well, thank you so much, John, for speaking with me, and thank you to everyone watching and listening. And John, I hope you have a lovely rest of your day, and same for everyone who's watching and listening to this. And yes, thank you so much, John. It's been
well. Thank you, Olivia. It's been really good to think through these areas and think through the questions, and really good to share that with the audience.
Absolutely. Well, we've really enjoyed listening. So, thank you so much, John, and bye, everybody.
Bye.